The same thing that Jesus is doing today. Once again, welcome you all to this special inaugural lecture, the 38th inaugural lecture of the Federal University of Agriculture. It is special because it's coming up as part of our 25th anniversary celebration. It is special because it's really the second of the Vice Chancellor and the Academic Dean of the University will be sitting on top of as a chairman. It is special because it is being given by a special our own professor of business, from the College of Natural Sciences. The first microbiologist.
Yeah. the Vice Chancellor of Staff, the Deputy Vice Chancellor of Athletics, the Deputy Vice Chancellor of Development, the Registrar, other principal officers of the University, the Dean of the College of Natural Sciences, other deans and directors, head of the Department of Microbiology, members of Senate and other colleagues, my own spiritual and temporal friends of the University and special guests, erudite academics, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, gentlemen of the press,
about the effects of bacteria. were discovered. Some of these bacteria were found to be responsible for food poisoning. And some important dates referring to those are assisted. Also, since there was foliage, there was poisoning. Attempts were made to find a way of obtaining this, which led to food preservation. Now, microorganisms can be divided and are often grouped into three major groups. We have the bacteria, we have the yeast, and we have the mold. Bacteria are microscopic organisms whose single cell are neither a membrane enclosing nucleus, nor other membranes. Enclosed organisms like mitochondria and chloroplasts, and they reproduce by binary fission. That's an example, that picture is an example of a bacteria cell under scanning electron microscope. Yeast also are single cell fungi, and they also reproduce vegetatively by body. And as seen under the electron microscope, there is a diagram of what a yeast cell can look like. The third group, molds, on the other hand, are filamentous, multicellular organisms, and they reproduce through spore formation. These spores are light and often spread through the air, water, and can be carried easily by insects. On this, microorganisms floating all over the places. Their mission really is to perpetuate their lives. Unfortunately, and sometimes fortunately, in the process of perpetuating their life, they become destructive and sometimes they become highly complementary to man, producing other things. In their activities in food, when they become destructive, they take food away from our tables. And when they become constructive, they bring food to our tables. This lecture will highlight the roles of microorganisms in food production from farm to fork. It will also give the nexus between microorganisms' struggle for perpetuity and how that can influence food availability. Also, strategies employed by man to overcome microbes' detrimental effects will be highlighted. Now, what is food? According to Encyclopedia Britannica 2011, food is any material consisting essentially of protein, carbohydrate, and fat used in the body of an organism to sustain growth, repair, carry out vital processes, and to furnish energy. Sources of food. Almost all foods are of plant or animal origin. When we look at plants, there are about 2,000 plant species which are cultivated for food, and several distinct cultivars. Many plants or plant parts are eaten as food, such as seeds,
fruits, and vegetables. Animals, on the other hand, are used as food directly or indirectly. Indirectly by the products obtained from these animals. Meat is an example of a direct product taken from the animal, while milk is an indirect material obtained from the animal to produce yogurt, cheese, and butter. Birds and other animals lay eggs, which are often eaten. Bees produce honey, which is a popular sweetener. What are the roles of these microorganisms in food production? Many of us have eaten fermented foods. We have taken fermented foods. Many of us already know that microorganisms are responsible for the fermentation of this food. When we talk of palm wine, when we talk of yogurt, even the cheese we take, they are all from fermented milk. By the effect of microorganisms on them. The enzymes are produced by the microorganisms and they convert whatever they need in them to products that are acceptable to us through the enzymes the microorganisms produce to be fermentation. In plants, microorganisms play a vital role in photosynthesis. And in mycorrhiza, we find microorganisms play a vital role, and without the presence of microorganisms, there will be no mycorrhiza activity. Also, probiotics, microorganisms present in food can produce antibiotics into the food. And these antibiotics would be of health importance to man. In soil, there are various types of microorganisms in the soil playing their role the way they always. They play the role in nitrogen cycle, they play their role in phosphorus cycle and water cycle. So, actually, life without microorganisms is an inert life. Let's quickly look at the detrimental effect of microorganisms in food. Microorganisms can contaminate food during harvest, storage, processing, distribution, handling, or preparation. And the primary source of microbial contamination are the soil, the air around us, animal hides and intestines, plant surfaces, sewage, and food processing machinery and utensils. So microorganisms are all over the place. And food contamination, apart from leading to spoilage, can also lead to foodborne poisoning, food poisoning and foodborne illnesses. Let's quickly look at food poisoning. Some of us have had what we call gastrointestinal disturbances after consuming some foods. And we may find ourselves vomiting or stooling. And it's at that stage we realize we are taking contaminated food. So food poisoning is defined as an illness caused by the consumption of food or water contaminated with bacteria or their toxins or with parasites
slavery from abdominal pain to vomiting to diarrhea to headache. And while some of these cases can lead to life-threatening symptoms, to permanent disability or even death, some of them can easily go off by themselves within 6 hours, probably depending on the type of food poisoning and depending on the immunity status of the person that has been attacked. Most food poisoning are light and improve without any specific medication, which is in table 2. This table 2 will show you some of the microorganisms, the type of food they affect, and the effect they give to man. You will see some of them that are self-limiting. Some of them will cause vomiting, diarrhea, and some may lead to death, like botulism, caused by Clostridium botulinum. When we talk of spoilage, we've all experienced food spoilage. It's the deterioration of food until it becomes unappetizing or unsuitable for human consumption. Food spoilage also means that the original nutritional value, the texture, the flavor of the food are damaged. The food becomes harmful to people and unsuitable to eat. Here, there, and then. On the screen, you see tomato being spoiled by Penicillium species, and even the orange by Penicillium digitatum. The beneficial contributions of microbes in food. Yes, they give us unwanted genes, but not always. They can transform our food materials, leading to the production of better, desirable foods. And this we can do using the whole cell of the microorganism. And we can even eat some of these microorganisms. There was a time it was a constant feature on the tables of the elites to have yeast that they would put into their food when eating. These are microorganisms that they add to their food to get protein. Whole yeast being eaten. We also have algae that can be eaten directly by man, as the Spirulina, edible seaweed. We have mushrooms, which are delicacies to some cultures in Nigeria. They are all microorganisms eating whole. All microorganisms can also be used to transform food when they are put on the food as a substrate, and they will convert the food to something else that will be more palatable or maybe more palatable to us, or have a higher keeping quality. We'll all agree that raw milk, if left on the table for a day, can easily go bad. But by the time you convert it to yogurt, you can keep it in a packaged form for about 7 days. That's a typical role of microorganism on a food substrate. The same thing for alcohol. Alcohol is produced from a carbohydrate source, and a lot of bottled alcohol has survived years without spoilage. So fermentation is almost as old as history. People have been using it to make sago, alcoholic beverages, vinegar, yogurt, cheese, as far as 700 BC. We have milk-based fermented products, as we have discussed, the yeast, the yogurts, the kefir, and also some other carbohydrates like cassava and yam are also fermented to give products that keep more than the original material. For example, cassava. If you leave it for too long, it could easily be destroyed. But when you convert it to lafu, fufu, garri, they will keep longer than cassava. Yam will be converted to elubo, and in the form of yam chips can also be kept for some time longer than ordinary yam. For those who love yam, they get yam from burning through the effect of yeast. And our bread, the bread at the table, comes from flour by the addition of yeast. The saccharomyces cerevisiae that we make it rise and then baked into bread. We also have cereals, Dioki. I'm sure some of us probably consumed Dioki this morning. Dioki is a fermented product from Asia, and it's a convenient food for infants, highly digestible. The same thing for Kolonzaki, which is often used as a refreshing drink, essentially in the month. Some of us enjoy fermented eggs like Iru, the locust beans, Ogiriga, say from melon, and Gawagawa. These are often used as condiments to season food. Microorganisms are placed on the locust bean to ferment into Iru, while on melon, they ferment it to Ogiri. That is highly nutritious and adaptable. We can just extract enzymes from microorganisms. If you don't want to use the whole microorganism, you can extract the enzymes and put it on this substrate, and it will give you a pure product of what you want. Examples of enzymes that have been extracted thus far are found in table 3, and the application, including baking, brewing, you can use them as sweetener. You can use them to clarify your juice. They are all on table 3. Microorganisms doing what they know how to do best, the application of their lives. And as you said, in the process, they destruct you and they may be constructive. This has led the speaker to look into the role some of these microorganisms play in food. So, my research contributions. And compounding the problem of food production and food insecurity is microbial distinction. The following will give a brief summary of microbial activities on local foods. In the manufacture, bringing food to our table are microorganisms. And a typical example is milk. compatible to Nuno, and Nuno has been found to be highly nutritious. Several minerals like potassium, calcium, zinc, sodium, iron, and magnesium are found in Nuno. And the group protein is about 1.2 to 5.7. Nutritious with a pH almost neutral, which is acceptable to any living thing. And in the process of converting milk to Nuno, streptococcus, including streptococcus pneumonis, streptococcus lactis, streptococcus diacetylactis, lactobacillus brevis, saccharomyces cerevisiae, were eliminated in Nuno fermentation. And it was found that just keep it at room temperature with these organisms with milk at room temperature between 25 degrees and 30 degrees, you will get something highly nutritious with low bacterial pH in it. And the shelter, even at 4 degrees centigrade, could be up to 12 days. And it was discovered that with improved packaging, the Nuno will last much, much longer. Please, also, let's show why microorganisms are often found in food. They are present in the air, they are present everywhere. And when they alert on this foods, they grow. Some foods were tested to see if they could be used as microbiological media for growth. Waste, cobalt waste, the one we throw away, especially during the rainy season, after eating the grains of the corn, and this corn now cause nuisance. We are grounded and they were used to grow microorganisms and they were found to be highly effective for the growth of bones. And Bacfale et al. In 2006 found out that with the use of these waste materials, one could reduce the cost of commercial growth media often used in our laboratories, microbiology laboratories to grow wood, from about 1,000 naira per liter to just 400,000 naira per liter. So, crops that are waste materials could be changed from waste to wealth. Very delicious to us that we just by on the road and we immediately start consuming contain a lot of microorganisms. In 1975, Mackey examined some food materials in and around Zaria. These foods, mostly snacks, were often processed by anybody who knew the art. Cereal, for example, or what cereal, even which we process on our roads here, kilishi, fura, they were all found to contain the microorganisms that we cannot easily see with our eyes. And these microorganisms were found to be of food spoilage and food poisoning implications. No wonder, after consuming some of these things, we find ourselves either vomiting or stewing. But as some of our people will say, Africans have immunity, and so keep munching. Especially in the southwest, called Aduyu. In 2005, Aduyu was bought from different markets. It's very interesting to note the raw materials used in making Aduyu. It's made from boiling, it's made from African yellow wood, which we call Enantia Orantha, lemongrass, Obito, which is the spinetant fluid of Obi. These three things are mixed together, they are boiled, and after boiling, pineapple peels are cut into pieces and put into it, and you get your yellow color. Go to the market right now, you see them selling their sachets from cellophane paper. Once you feel you have malaria. Aduyu has been found locally to treat many ailments.